factors around menopause and andropause and ways that we can work to reduce it. And then she got inspired to bring a great friend of hers, another physician, along, who's going to present instead. So I'm going to bring up Bobbi to share about her inspiration.
Well, after the last presentation, we were all so inspired, and sexual vitality is a subject near and dear to all of our hearts. And one of my great mentors in this subject area and a fellow colleague is Dr. Philip Miller. So it is my pleasure to tell you a little bit about him before I introduce him. He's a person that I've been inspired by because it's not often that when you need help from somebody that somebody looks at all of you and they consider you with a sense of your wholeness on all levels of hormonal, physical, emotional, and mental and spiritual awareness. And my friend, Dr. Philip Miller, is one of those people. So this is a journey that is for him has been a long way. He spent 20 years as a well-seasoned emergency room physician, and then he spent another 15 years in urgent care. And after that, he spent the last 15 years, a little condensed, as a leading edge teacher and physician in anti-aging medicine. So when I first got into the field, I of course sought out anybody that had any knowledge, and he was one of the people that has helped me the most. And his sense of care for the patient and a sense of really fairness, recognizing the innate wisdom within all of us that is guiding us and fostering that innate wisdom with his care and his very competent expertise is what led me to this idea to bring him here and present him to all of you. And it is with great appreciation and respect that I present to you Dr. Philip Miller.
You know, I've always said to people, you know, when your head quit, you should just quit. When your head. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you, Bobbi. What I want to do tonight is, I think that you've probably had some, I don't know how many of you people have been part of the ongoing series here, but I want to give you my introduction to anti-aging medicine, longevity medicine, what that's all about. And then within that, I want to show you why sexual vitality, and that was sort of the lecture title today, Vitality, Sexuality Over 45. And I want to show you why those two are really part of the continuum. So I'm going to give you a broad overview and show you what we've discussed in the past in terms of why anti-aging medicine, what is it, and then how that leads into, you know, one of the goals that we have, which is maintaining vigor and vitality well into 50, 60, 70, 80, 90. And, you know, who are the people that we look to right now as the icons, and, you know, who are we going to be looking at in the next, you know, 10 or 15 years? So, I don't know if anybody remembers this. Anybody remember this? I think this was the 50th anniversary of the bridge.
Oh, yeah. I was there.
See? Someone, see? Anybody know what this is? This is famous photography. So, this is just to get us in the mood here. This one I took. This is where I spent 25 years in the Big Sur area. The Status Longevity Institute is a center that I started and founded approximately six and a half years ago with the charter of practicing anti-aging medicine. And one of the toughest things was when I started this, and still today, is that is our charter, is anti-aging medicine. So it's not, well, we do really orthopedics, we do plastic surgery, we do a number of other specialties. That is our charter. And so because of that, the focus of that is it gives us a lot more experience in terms of looking at this as a complete and sophisticated and really rich practice, which, as you'll see as I develop this, is the future of medicine. And I'll tell you why I think that. So here's the title, Sexuality 45 and Beyond. We start out with some basic concepts. Ken Dickwall, who actually is going to be the keynote speaker at the A4M, next, in about 2 weeks from now, who's an amazing guy. And probably one of the guys who influenced me the most, going back 10, 12 years ago. Because he was the one who really began to formulate and to communicate this idea of what is the age wave, which basically is baby boomers growing older, and showed how the focus is going to be shifted. And you look at some of the things, some of the predictions, healthcare facilities going to be pushed for the limit. This was from 1993, none of this has changed. You look at one of my favorite quotes from Woody Allen, which is, I don't want to live forever through my work, so I want to live forever by not dying. So, you know that Woody Allen was one of the original writers for Sid Caesar? So I don't know if anybody's old enough to remember Sid Caesar, but Sid Caesar had an amazing group of people behind him. He was one of them. Okay, so here's some statistics. These are really compelling statistics, and they get more important every year, and I'll tell you why. 76 million baby boomers in North America. Baby boomers are turning 50 at the rate of one every 18 seconds for the next 20 years. They've always been on the leading edge, will continue to be on the leading edge, count for the greatest demographic bulge. This is in all the first world. It's not only here, but it's in Japan, it's in Europe, okay? And so we need to begin to look at, you know, redefining the aging process, what that means, because there's a lot of us in the old way practicing medicine is imploding. Why? Look at life expectancy, 1950 and 1985, or 1850, actually that should be 1850. And when I first gave this lecture, you can see right here, that bar there, the red bar there, is when Social Security first was enacted. So you can see when Social Security was first enacted, the life expectancy was 60. So where do you think this 65 figure came from? You know, retiring, Social Security at 65. You think that they asked a bunch of physicians or PhDs? This was a complete political compromise. And it was based on the notion that at that time, said, well, if we made it 70, everybody's going to be dead, so that won't work too good. If we make it 60, yeah, that might, so they figured, well, let's make it 65. So they really figured, because you go just a little bit beyond, they figured they don't have to pay out for about 3 years. Okay? So that was easy. They only have to pay out for 3 years. And not only that, if you look at here, here's, you know, a history of aging. The idea is that what we call square the curve. This is the baby boom cycle. But it gets more powerful here. Here's the growth of population over 65. Over 65, but here's the growth over 85.
Wow.
Look at this. Fastest growing segment of our population, percentage-wise, is over 85. So that's why, you know, when Willard Scott used to do the, here's the lady, she's 102, let's give her a round of applause. You're gonna see more and more of this. That's not gonna be a big deal in the next 20 years, okay? Whereas it was a big deal, say, the last 20 years. So here we go, we got this growing population. Here's the strain on Medicare. And here's the critical thing, and I'm going to show you why this is important. Look at this, workers per Medicare recipient. See, 1965, 2040, let's go to 2000, 3.9, 2020, 2.8. What's happening is more people are coming into Medicare and less people are putting into it. What do you think that means? Our taxes. Working harder. Working hard for all these old people. You know, you're 22, 23 years old. Okay? So what you've got is you've got a system where you've got more people going in and actually less people supporting it. So what does that mean? System goes broke. And it's well known. This is why you hear in Washington, they're all talking about Social Security. You don't hear them talking about Medicare. Because they all know Medicare is going broke by about 2010. Because it was up in 2013, but they've ruined the budget. So it's now coming back to about 2008 to 2010. What I mean broke, I mean no money. There's a thing I just saw from the CMA, California Medical Association, where some legislation was supposed to go through Congress and it failed. there was a cut to physicians for Medicare payment of about 2.5%, and then now there's an additional like 8%. So the first thing is, don't pay the physicians. That's the first thing. So just don't pay the physicians. So if you try to figure out why your, you know, your parents, and they're not getting their Medicare like they used to, less dollars going into the system, and eventually there's just not going to be anything.
Better buy bonds than buy money.
Exactly. I mean, why? You know, why not?
Okay.
So, what does that mean? We need to start thinking differently. It's imperative. There's an economic, political, social, and then a medical imperative to think differently, because this system is going broke. If you see the patients that I see, patients that, you know, all my colleagues see right now, the level of medical care is just dropping precipitously. You nobody's getting diagnosed any longer. Everybody's just kind of sliding on everything. And that's because, you know, the emphasis now is on cost control, not service, not diagnosis, not all the things that I was taught when I was a medical student, which is, you know, what's a serum porcelain, what's a serum iron, how do you work, have you remembered all these bizarre syndromes? You don't care about that anymore. It's all cost. We need a new paradigm. So the new paradigm is anti-aging medicine. Why? Personal responsibility. It's adding life to your years, not just years to your life. So it's not just longevity. This is a quality of life issue. Okay? So what it isn't is growing old gracefully, or maybe not so gracefully. And incidentally, what's interesting to me is in anti-aging medicine, you'll see that there's what I call sort of the regression to the mean amongst the sexes, that you can't really quite tell which is male, which is female, because they're kind of going together there. Again, wonderful gentleman, but growing old gracefully, that's not the paradigm. Okay? It's a quality of life issue. It's not just about age. It's about having no limits. So, you know, we look to, you know, something like this, and this could be a guy 20, 30, could be a guy 60, 70 now, okay? It's about vitality, it's about no limits. It's about people doing things without regard to age. It's about having an attitude, because growing old is an attitude, okay? So you take people who are 80 now, I mean, look at this. This guy has no limits. This guy is not thinking, I better be careful. This guy, this is amazing. Okay, or how about this guy here? This guy is what I call the poster boy for anti-aging medicine. This is when he was 78. The only way he cheats a little bit is he always uses young models. But I swear this guy gets younger as this guy gets older. He's now 81. He actually looks better. Okay? Or my hero, I mean, absolutely my hero, and he was just in the news again. And everybody remembers him from here in the 50s, and that is
Jacqueline.
Okay. So here's a picture of Jack at 81, okay? And I got a picture at the end here, he's 85, he's still just as strong. So here in the Bay Area, we remember him when he was 65, 1,000-pound barge from, you know, from Alcatraz. I mean, you know, nobody can even swim from Alcatraz, let alone 1,000 pounds behind him. So Jack has no limits. I had the pleasure of speaking to Jack a couple of years ago because I really wanted to talk to him. And we were talking, he was telling me all these dirty jokes and telling me how he still gets up at 5 o'clock in the morning, still works out every day, same routine that he's been doing for the last 50 years. And the thing he told me is, I hate talking to old people. He falls asleep on me, and I love talking to young people. So, and when you saw this thing, he was on TV a couple of weeks ago. Someone said to you, how do you feel? Is that, I felt the same as I felt when I was 25. Mental. He's been working at it, but Jack knows that aging is a mental construct. Okay? So the new paradigm is based on some of these constructs. Again, you know, another hero. Here's John Glenn, age 77, going back into space, second time. And, you know, maybe they cut him a little slack, but trust me, they didn't cut him that much slack. He had to be fit. And if you look at it this way here, would you look at his eyes? Would you look at the intensity of his eyes? I mean, this is a guy here who's there. His presence, cognitive, physical. Again, there's no age limit here. This is not a guy who's worried about how old he is. And this is what we got to look to. We have to look at aging as a treatable condition. It's not a disease. It's not an illness. It's a treatable condition. And that's what I'm going to emphasize here. Condition means it's not a disease or an illness. Okay? So again, to reiterate, the age wave, we've got baby boomers turning 50, it's a prodigious rate. We've got this concept of forever young because we need to learn about responsibility, motivation, taking care of yourself, because if you understand what I've given you here so far, government's not going to be there. They ain't going to have the dollars. Your docs aren't going to be there. They're already going out the door. You're going to have to learn how to assume this vigor and vitality yourself in conjunction and in partnership, you know, with good anti-aging physicians and other physicians who are going to understand this practice. I'm going to begin to tell you a little bit more about what this is all about. Just to kind of remember where we came from. We all did quite that, look pretty young. I'll remember that. We all remember this. Wasn't that long ago. And I put this in here just to remind us that, you know, there one time there was hope. There was a vision. There was a reason for looking to our leaders for other than dropping bombs. So what's the goal? Goals Forever Young. This just came out in the magazine many years ago. Whether it's forever young or not, again, I think you're beginning to sense that what we're doing is trying to push these limits. Okay? So that's sold good press. So what I want to do is I want to show you real quickly kind of some of the icons of, you know, what we have grown up with over the last, say, 50, 60, 70 years in terms of what are the icons of sexuality, sensuality. And a lot of that comes from movie stars, okay? So we go back to, does anybody remember who this is? Marlena Dietrich?
Yeah, sure.
And the thing that really amazes me is, when before I did this, Marlena Dietrich, because she's way before in my time, I mean, she was just a name, but she, I could see why she was really a screen beauty of her time. I mean, this is an ageless face. And then we go to more classic Jean Harlow, and that whole 30s look, and Mae West, late 30s, early 40s, and that whole playfulness and coquettishness, and her whole centeredness, because she knew who she was and what she was doing. And then we kind of moved ahead to someone who, for some reason, will never, ever lose her allure. I mean, Marilyn Monroe, probably in 50 years, people will be talking about her. So there's something ageless and timeless about this. This is actually my favorite one from Dr. Strange, from Dr. Zhivago. Sophia Loren, another one, an ageless beauty, probably still one of the most sexy women in the world, and now over 70. I mean, young movie actors will go up to her. I mean, I've heard this just in the last year or two. They'll go up to her and they'll say, "You really do look beautiful." So, and she knows that. So again, you know, this is even that sexuality, sensuality, the thing that it just that we've learned through the screen and learned through public. She's never lost it. She'll never lose it. Raquel Welch, more into the 90s, a different look. And again, a different look. And I'm kind of showing you the evolution of whole female form, and again, in terms of what is sexuality, and now it's become more muscular and a different definition. So you kind of see all these different forms that we look at. And then the one that I really like, Barbara Eden, remember? Jeannie. She's about 63, 64. You know? So, vigor and joy underlies this. And it's one of the things, both in terms of anti-aging medicine, in terms of sexuality, And this is the thing that we're looking for. We're all looking for joy. We're all looking for vigor. You know, even the Constitution guarantees us the right to the pursuit of happiness. That's actually written in the Constitution. Remember that part? The right to the pursuit of happiness.
They're making it harder right now.
Okay? Making it impossible. They're trying to actually legislate that out. We could have another talk on that. Passion and joy. Again, I mean, this is all part of it. I mean, it's almost like, I don't have to explain this, but these are the attributes that we're looking at. And then you go into further attributes of, you know, what is spiritual focus? It's all part of the whole sexual experience. So it kind of moves all these things. What are all the things that we can do to keep that alive? Okay. Now, I'll tell you this. Don't do this in your living room unattended. This is scary. It's more scary for me than you. This is what I call... Like I said, this is scary because this is me. So as a plastic surgeon, you say, well, you can see this, and you can see that. But the totality of it is all you can see how your face changes. And then we wish we could all do that. Well, anti-aging medicine, you know, we can't quite do that. We haven't achieved that yet. We'll get there, okay? But what are some of the things that we can do? Okay? This was just to see if everybody was still awake.
Continue it so you start looking like one of your favorite movie stars or something. That's right.
So let's go through some of, you know, let's kind of break this down. Now I'm going to be a little bit more clinical and kind of thread this through. So clinically, you know, what are the things that I look at when people come to me? You know, both men and women who are beginning to lose their libido, beginning to lose sexual enjoyment, beginning to lose that edge. And I got to tell you, one of the most interesting and actually one of the most gratifying things to me, in the last 5 years in doing this, is that, you know, the people who come to see me, you know, understand that, A, I give people a lot of time. I'm not into quantity. This is where I've completely broken the medical paradigm. I'm not into quantity. So I don't see max more than 5 people a day. I'm into time. And so what it does is allows us to develop a rapport, and we joke, and we have fun, and so forth. It also allows people, when they come to see me, to develop that kind of rapport where, you know, we'll talk about what's going on in the industry, you know, what's going on here, what's going on there. And we have a good time, as well as a tremendous amount of education and information being imparted. And so one of the things that's really been interesting to me, and I probably don't need to tell you this, but it's just, as a physician, it's so interesting. This notion that, you know, only men enjoy sex and women really don't, is complete BS. That I can't tell you how many women will come to me at the age of 46 and 48, 49, and say, you know, I used to love this. And I, you know, my libido's off, and I don't, and I really want to, and just, what can we do about this? It was really interesting. One of my patients, a lady who was an ear nurse and a plastic surgeon's nurse, she's 70. And she started talking about her own sexuality. She says, you know, there's nothing worse than a horny 70-year-old lady. And so, you know, it's interesting that this is both a male and a female thing. And so how do we break this thing down? Well, the most sexual thing is here. It's the brain. It's the visual thing for men. Men are visually oriented. Women, there's more of the emotional, the feeling, this feels right, I feel secure, I feel warm. But it still starts here. That libido, that sensuality, anticipation, starts here. Okay? And then you have the hormonal influence, testosterone, estrogen, which is a really important part of it, and really allows you to feel sexy and lustful, but it's not all of it, but it helps. Then what you hear about is the vascular component of it, which is where Viagra and some of the newer drugs come in, which is basically performance, erectile function, erectile dysfunction. And for women, I think it's the same thing. I just don't think it has been studied the same amount. I think it's the same clitoral engorgement. I think it's the same phenomenon of, you know, engorgement and the whole tumescence and like, we're getting there, we're getting ready. Neuronal, really important, how the nerves work, are they not working? Diabetic, are there other things going on? And finally, muscular. I'm sexual act, there's little teen, the pubococcygeus muscles, and a little floor, I mean, and the way the prostate secretes, and so there's little teeny accessory muscles in here that respond to testosterone. So you have these components here, and then I kind of started breaking them down maybe a little bit more subjectively, which again, libido, which is arousal, excitement, mood, lust, all of that. Function, the interesting thing is the functional component of sex, if you had to actually put it together by committing, it'd like, it would take you years to learn this. Luckily, it just comes naturally because it's really a complex interplay. I'm going to show you between the parasympathetic and the sympathetic nerve system, and just at a certain point, you have to kind of shift gears, and the body knows how to do all that stuff. But there's that complex array that we're trying to preserve. Orgasm, again, complex. This is the thing that people come to me for. It's not quite as strong, it's not quite as satisfying, it's not there at all. What are the things that we can do to make this better to where I used to be? Intimacy, which is at the point at which sex really becomes the final act. I mean, that's really what we all probably enjoy the most, which is now it's just two beings. No clothes, it's just two beings fusing, and that's where the spiritual part becomes more into play, and that's where you start getting into Kundalini yoga and tantric yoga and higher order aspects. But I wanted to break this down in terms of all this is part of the sex act, all of it. And so these are things that, you know, how are the ways that we can kind of look at it from my standpoint in terms of how do I segment and how are the things that I can. Okay, here's what we can do here and here to put this experience back together again for you, or maintain it. If you look at why this becomes a problem, you can see, as we get older, you can see not only hormonal activity is declining with age, but you see enzymatic and liver and digestive function. So a lot of things are decreasing with age. The digestive is really important one. And, you know, this is where I always defer to Bobbi. Because I always say, you know, then there's the digestive stuff, and that's the stuff that's always harder for me. Because the hormonal thing, I can get phenomenal results within a week sometimes, whereas the digestive, it takes a lot longer, and yet it's so vital to making all the rest of this work. But you see, it's all declining as we get older, so it all needs a little help, a little push, a little help from our friends. So, this is a feedback loop. Kind of like in the computer industry, our brains, our bodies function in a homeostatic way in a feedback loop. And this is sort of a paradigm for almost all hormones. I'm going to concentrate on sex hormone, but almost all hormones, thyroid, growth hormone, adrenal, almost all of them have this feedback, which is at the top there is the top of the brain, center of the brain, hypothalamus, very primitive part that controls vegetative, emotional, sexual functions, controls all that. Then it goes down and kind of gives little set messages to the pituitary, which is the main gland that secretes all the main tropic hormones, the ones that control everything. And that then goes down, FSH, LH, and it goes down and FSH promotes estrogen. The men FSH controls sperm production. And the LH in women controls progesterone. And in men, LH controls testosterone. Which brings out an interesting point here. There is no such thing as male and female hormones. there is no such thing, and I really have, I take issue with a lot of people on this. Yeah, to me, there's no such thing as male or female medicine. I don't like that term, women's medicine. Because, well, what happened to men's medicine? And I thought we were all kind of human beings. And I will tell you that most men, after 50, have higher estrogen levels than their wives. Wow. So that's kind of interesting. And I can get the progesterone levels up much higher. Oh, but I thought progesterone only had to do with periods. So what are men doing with progesterone? That's kind of weird, because last I checked, I don't remember too many guys having periods. So maybe we ought to re-look at these. So even the old concept of FSH, follicle stimulating hormone, we need to get rid of that term. Not going to happen. I'm being a little facetious here. But it's rooted in follicle stimulating hormone, whereas it applies to men just as much. Same thing, LH, luteinizing hormone, well, that promotes testosterone in men. So what I want to get across to you is the important thing that I do is I'm not so interested in male or female as much as what are the balances, what are the ratios, what do I consider, you know, healthy and optimal ranges at each age group. But all these hormones operate in all of us. And so the idea is to get the optimal amount for each one of us. And they're different. And I take enough time, and I've done this long enough to where, and I was telling one of my patients today, to me, I really feel, I'm almost at like a grandmaster level. I look at these things not as lab values, but as patterns. And so when I look at lab values, I look at, you know, what's the pattern, where is this going, what does this mean, what's the significance? And I get a sense of, you know, if you're a little bit more male-oriented, more a little female-oriented, and people will tell me their moods and their emotions, how they're feeling, and I say, okay, we can tweak a little here, a little there, and that's going to get you right in the zone. Small little changes there by looking at patterns, ratios, and looking at a much bigger picture here, other than just, oh, you're in the normal range, because that has no value. Most physicians don't understand this. You do not get it. And that's why I don't like patients doing their own lab either. It's because all you do is you're looking at a lab range, you say it's in the normal, and it means nothing to me. What you're interested in, is it optimal? What's the balance here? How does the whole big picture look? Okay. So I'm giving you kind of a big picture here. And again, what I was showing is that, you know, in men, there's this visual thing. That's why men are so visual, and women are smell and feel. And how does this feel, and security? I mean, we respond initially differently before we kind of come together with the same degree of satisfaction and pleasure. So there's different things driving us. If you see this, Cerulean's locus is in there. It's a real small little area there. Had some, I mean, nobody's heard of this. I remember studying this in the late 60s, because this thing controls sleep. This area, that locus cerulea, is going to become really important in the next few years. Again, complex diagram.
Why is that?
Why? Because I think it's going to explain to us, and this is my own theory, one of the biggest problems that I see nobody has an answer to, and I say anybody who really gets this is going to get a Nobel Prize, which is intractable pathologic insomnia. What is that all about? People who just cannot fall asleep. I mean, there's millions, tens of millions of people who are taking all these drugs to go to sleep. And there's a variety of reasons, but I think that's part of it. There's some other things. But it's just one little key to why people can't fall asleep. This shows you how complex the whole sexual act is in men. And again, there is the same physiology going on in women. It's obvious, more obvious in men than women, but it's the same thing. And again, it's this balance between sympathetic arousal and parasympathetic, which is an actual process of having an orgasm. It's like you're going into one gear, and then suddenly you have to shift into another gear. It's probably in some reasons why guys sometimes will have performance anxiety, because you can get into one mode, but then you can't quite slip into the other mode. It shows you how complex it is, but also the neuronal portion of it. So remember I showed you all these different things? You know, complex, just the neuronal aspect of it is. And And I just copied this just the other day, just to show you again how, you know, physicians look at things pathologically, all the pathological substrates. So just a little list here. You know, what are things that can cause dysfunction? Well, there's a whole list. I don't know if you go through these, but there's a list. Blood pressure, vascular. What are the first attributes of vascular compromise? High blood pressure, atherosclerosis, stiffening of the pipes is erectile dysfunction. Diabetes, same thing. Diabetes is just accelerated vascular complications. Cholesterol, same thing. Vascular disease, multiple sclerosis, neuronal, spinal cord. So you have all these problems here are potential attributes, but that's not the main reason people come to see me. And there's other ones, cigarette smoking, alcohol. Alcohol is actually a big one. Get real drunk. Can't figure out why you can't quite have the right sex. Too relaxed. So here's some of the things. This is just a brief overview of, you know, what are the things that we have to offer people? How do we look at it? What are the things that we have to offer people in terms of what can we do to regain sexual vigor and enjoyment and fulfillment? Ginseng. Probably taking me another 10 years to really understand ginseng. But as much as I can do it, as much as I've talked to all the masters in the United States, the way I look at it is simply Chinese and Korean ginseng are stimulating, really stimulating, really feel good. Siberian ginseng is not really a ginseng, it's kind of a cousin, it's a different genus. The one that I'm doing more and more is American ginseng, that one's kind of common. But these things really help adrenals, and I think the Chinese and Korean have certain mild aphrodisiac effects. Yohimbine or yohimbine, these things are terribly stimulating. And urologists will use this, but I'm not sure that they use it in the right way, because they say, well, here's the PDR, and it says just take this, it's like 2.5 milligrams or something like that, 3 times a day. And everybody comes back and says, whoa, this is way too stimulating. It's like, you know, they couldn't even get near anybody because they were just too stimulated. So I'm not sure that that's the way they were doing it in the Amazon, where they really knew, no, you just take a little of the leaf, you do just right here, they probably really had it. We put a capsule, here's the active ingredient. I don't think we know what we're doing. So I think yohimbine probably is a better product than yohimbine. Tribulus is another way of getting up testosterone. Chrysin.
Is that tribulus terrestris?
Yeah. These are some of the ones I don't drink too
much.
What
does tribulus do?
Tribulus.
What does it do?
Tribulus, I don't know too much about tribulus. Tribulus, I think, just is one of the things that increases androstenedione, which then maybe can increase testosterone. So it helps increase testosterone, but not directly, and not really the best way of doing it. Weightlifters do a lot of this, because it's easy to get. Same thing with the chrysin. Chrysin is just another way of using what I use, a much more potent form. It helps keep testosterone in the testosterone form without aromatizing into the estrogen form. So chrysin is sort of a simple way over the counter of promoting more testosterone and keeping those estrogen levels down. And Uranoparama, another one of these things, you see in all these products, not an expert in this one, but you see it in almost all the ones, keep your sexual vitality, you know.
That's a rainforest.
It's a rainforest. Okay. So here now we get into some, you know, drugs, and a lot of this really comes down to endothelial relaxation factor. An endothelial relaxation factor is really cardiac, vascular, and then we obviously worry about, you know, in genital vessels, and penis, and down the clitoral area. But what we're looking at is what the cardiologists in the last, say, 5, maybe 10 years, beginning to focus on a little bit more, which is endothelial dysfunction. And endothelial dysfunction is kind of the inner layer of the arterial tree that really, I think, is rich with hormones, most of which they haven't even begun to discover yet. So I think even in the heart, I think there's a lot of intrinsic hormones in the heart they haven't begun to discover. What we do know is arginine, nitric oxide, endothelial relaxation factor is one thing, and out of that whole concept came Viagra, because Viagra is kind of promoting that whole arginine, nitric oxide synthetase where you're dilating up arteries and you're trying to get arteries to be healthy. So Viagra, we know the story of Viagra, great seller. done phenomenally well. Even Hef claims that he uses a case of that a week, whatever. So, I mean, nobody's even embarrassed to say, talk about using Viagra now, except for maybe a few people in the porn industry, and even they are beginning to admit, yeah, well, a few of them take that. So, I mean, obviously, Viagra, the story is well known. So there's a new drug that's coming out, Cialis, that's going to be coming out in Europe in the next couple of months. Probably won't see it here for a couple of years. Has less side effects. Doesn't have quite the same
problems. What side effects with Viagra?
Visual problems. Sometimes you get hypotensive. But
visual problems.
I think there's some problems with some visual disturbances, and then it goes beyond that. Mm. So I haven't seen too much of this. But there are some.
Congestion too.
Well, congestion is a real common one. So congestion, almost all guys will tell me they get really congested. But the serious ones, there's some visual problems that can be sometimes even permanent that guys get.
You mean seeing double vision or something? Or?
No, beyond that. I have to look that up because, again, I don't see this too often. But there are occasionally some things. And so what they've been looking at are some that don't even have these congestions, some of these other side effects. Okay. I got one guy who comes to see me. He's 65. And for years, he's been taking 50 and 200. He's taking 300 milligrams a day. Now, first of all, you have to calculate that out. Comes out to be probably about $1,000 a month he's spending on Viagra. Okay. But then I was trying to figure out why this guy at 65, every time I saw this guy's blood pressure was 90 over 60. Now, young, skinny women who are 23 years old or 30 or older occasionally have 90 over 60, but not guys who are 60. You don't see them. And he went to his cardiologist. Yeah, that's fine. That's normal. It's not normal. That's not a normal blood pressure for a guy that age. So I started beginning to think, for a guy that age, typically an average would be maybe probably about 130 over 85 and above. But 90 over 60 is not a typical or even normal, and I don't think it's even healthy blood pressure for any guy. So I was starting to look at, maybe this guy was having some aortic problems, and then he began to say, no, I'm taking a lot of Viagra. So I started thinking, damn, Viagra's got to be probably the most expensive but most significant way of lowering your blood pressure out there. I mean, we should all be taking Viagra as the best, most safe way of lowering your blood pressure, right? Because this guy was doing a whole lot. Well, going back, I don't think Medicare's going to pay for that one. That's going to happen. Cabrajack is another one of these things where, I don't use it. I don't know a lot about it. Personally, I've always thought injecting yourself, it didn't sound like a way of getting in the mood to me. I mean, women would say, I don't like putting that diaphragm in or taking the pill. And the guys think, I got to go inject myself. I'm like, geez, that's. But for some guys who have a lot of difficulty, this has really been a lifesaver. Because you're little teeny needle directing right into the dorsal penile vein there, and that really helps them. Okay? Little teeny needle. Okay, so they get used to it. So it's like.
That's when you want to get turned on.
So you all think about that, but again, now think about a guy who can't get it up at all. At all. Okay? That's better than nothing. So you got to frame it within your perspective. No, I'm looking at all the way from, what's healthy to people who really have problems that they still want this, okay? Hinko biloba is an antioxidant. It's good for the brain. I use it actually a lot for the heart. This may not sound like this is really a vascular thing, but I wanted to put this in here because this is going to really be a blockbuster. And I'm actually sort of privy to a very small supply of this that was made by a friend of mine who had his chemist make that. And it's a drug called Altian 711. So that's just the name. And this is in phase 3 trials with a company, Altian Pharma. You can look that up, Altian Pharma. This is going to be an amazing drug. Because what it is one of the theories of aging, there's a number of them, one of the main theories of aging is collagen cross-linking. And that means as we get older, you get these things who are glycoproteins. So sugar sticks to protein, and sugar that sticks to protein gets into your skin, and it gets into this skin here, and it gets into your muscles and gets to your arteries, and it starts getting everything stiff. And it doesn't work as well. So your blood pressure goes up because your arteries get stiff. Or this starts sagging, you lose elasticity, or your lens starts getting stiff, or your bladder doesn't work as well. So all these things, all cancer cell 11, within a month, starts reversing a lot of this stuff. And I've done just my own small little trial of this so far with a few of my patients. One guy, blood pressure initially when he came to see me was 200 over 130. Put him on blood pressure medication, got it down to 150, down to eventually, I think we were down to about 135 over about 90. He's been on this for a month. He's now down to 120 over 80, and we haven't done anything different. Okay. This drug is going to come out initially for diabetes. If you caught what I said a little while ago, I've been treating diabetes for 30 years. And I see more and more, because I'm really more and more into, you know, what's the essence of all this?
Which one are you seeing for diabetes?
Diabetes is a vascular phenomenon waiting to happen. It's not a blood sugar problem. It's a global metabolic problem. It's got all these things here. But it is basically, in the essence, functionally, diabetes is a vascular problem waiting to happen. So it's a heart attack, stroke, peripheral neuropathy, or your kidneys failing. Diabetes is accelerated aging. So diabetes is kind of a model, in a sense, for aging. So here you now you have Alkan 711, which they'll bring out for diabetes because you get all these, you know, glycoproteins will break all that stuff down, or people with lipoprotein A, high lipoprotein A level. But eventually, this is going to be one of the first true blockbuster drugs for anti-aging. Because of all the work, because of how universal all this collagen linking stuff is. So again, remember I said, you know, the first sign of vascular disease is going to be genital. That's why this all fits in here.
How far away is it? I didn't follow you.
I'd say this is probably another, you know, because it works slowly, 3 to 5 years before it's going to be marketed. Because they're in phase 3 trials right now. And I've looked at it, I don't see, as far as I can tell, I can't see anything dangerous about this drug. I've been taking it. I see nothing wrong with it. It's actually finasteride thiazolium chloride. It's a small little molecule. And can't see any side effects from this here. And there's chelation therapy. And chelation therapy is another one that has helped a lot of my patients. You know, they come into me for cardiovascular problems, coronary artery disease. And after about 12 treatments, they'll say, you know, it's working better. I mean, was that supposed to happen? I said, yeah. So and it's straight now, too. They're all really amazed that chelation therapy, again, remember, first sign is going to be erectile dysfunction. So the first thing is going to kind of recover there before the cardiovascular vessel. Probably going to be the penile vessels, okay? So chelation therapy has great value. And this is not something anybody talks about very much, even in the chelation therapy community. Hardly even say, oh yeah, this is really good for erectile dysfunction. But boy, that's been my experience, is that this is another modality. The interesting thing, though, is again, I like talking in front of lay audiences. I don't talk hardly ever in front of physicians. This just drives physicians up a wall. Completely drives them nuts. And why? It's completely irrational. There is no reason for this driving docs up a wall. It's just, it's not part of their normal routine. Okay, so, you know, we shift gears here.
Mostly male doctors, or what are females?
All docs. They go nuts over chelation therapy. So not all of them, okay? So think about this for a second. 20 years ago, you know, I come to one of you and he says, you know, I want to get rid of all these wrinkles. And I said, I got something really cool. It's botulism. What? No way, man. I got that next one. Okay. What's the hottest thing right now in the plastic surgery community?
Botox.
Now, how did that one get through? Okay. Marketing, good politics, and I don't know, something else. But the point is what becomes legitimized, and this is something that I'm really interested in, and something that you guys should be interested in, is what is it that legitimizes certain procedures, drugs, therapeutic avenues, approaches, and what doesn't legitimize it? What legitimized Botox, but chelation therapy, oh, we don't want to touch that, okay? What is it? And it's not logic, it's not rationality, and don't give me this stuff about double-blind studies, because there's hardly any surgical procedures that have good double-blind studies. And I can show you most studies are flawed, critically flawed. 80% of all studies that you read about, including the recent one on this growth hormone study that I'd love to talk on, or all that stuff that you were fretting about in July about the JAMA study on estrogen, which really wasn't estrogen, it was Premarin, not estrogen, and Provera, which is not progesterone. So you have to look behind all this. What legitimizes these things? What brings it into, oh, this is okay and this is not okay? What did Stanford say about it? What did UC San Francisco say about it? You know, in your community, you know, what did the Buck Institute say about it? You know, I mean, everybody looks to these big institutes and say, well, is this legitimate or is it not, okay? And so these are the kinds of things when you look at anti-aging medicine, begin to look at, well, what are the modalities, what are the therapies that we use, what are the approaches to sexuality, what are the approaches that we use in general that, you know, make it legitimate or not legitimate, what are the things that, you know, I'm interested, I'm not interested. Because the thing that I love about anti-aging medicine, and I think you can begin to get a sense of it right now, anti-aging medicine is not alternative medicine. Anti-aging medicine is what I've been trying to do ever since I was a medical student, which is just basically, it's a larger toolbox. So a guy comes to me with cardiovascular problems, he still gets his, you know, DIG, or maybe he gets his Lasix, or he gets all, you know, all the drugs that he needs, but he also gets his testosterone, his carnitine, and his taurine, and his CoQ10, and he gets all the other things that really make it work, okay? So the anti-aging medicine, all these approaches to sexuality is just enlarging the toolbox. So I'm giving you some of the standard approaches, some of the non-standard approaches. And here's the feedback, failing hormone. This is what we talked about this before. So hormonally, some of the things that I do, both for men and women, is we look at testosterone, because testosterone will increase libido, although that's not the main thing. Still has to be there. And it will help with sexuality. And women tend to respond to testosterone more vigorously, quicker, and actually more successfully than men. I mean, a woman usually will come back in a week and say, that worked pretty good. Or like, that was way too much. I need to back off. I started to rip people off. I was honking the horn. Okay, just lower that dose a little
bit. Start wars.
Not too many. Who did? Go to my ear. So that's one where women actually respond quicker than men. Men will take a little longer, use creams, use lozenges. I don't use injections, okay? And we have to use larger doses. So younger guys who come to see me,
You don't use injections?
Huh?
You don't use injections?
No. Younger guys come to see me, and what I mean by younger guys are like 27. On up to give or take around 40. I'm a lot more careful using any of these hormones in guys who are 40 because I don't want to put some guy on something like testosterone, even at good doses, knowing that he's going to be on this for 40 years. As opposed to a guy who comes to see me at 55 where, listen, I mean, this is a slam dunk. They're low, you're going to need this if you want this, and I'm only doing this for maybe 20 years. 25 years, okay? So I'm a lot more careful and my approach changes when I see younger guys. So I started using Clomid, which was originally used for infertility. Increases LH. LH then increases testosterone. And it's a sort of a therapeutic and a diagnostic way of telling, is the end organ, the testicle, working? Because if I use Clomid, LH goes up. Testosterone goes up. That means, hey, your testicles are still working.
So it's just as effective.
In the guys that I use it, it's as effective, and yet, even though it's as effective, I still end up giving testosterone, they still say, this still feels better. So even if the levels are up, they still respond to the testosterone with this, you know, that's what I'm looking for.
Okay.
So I do this sort of therapeutically, and I use it diagnostically. HCG has been used. HCG is secreted during pregnancy. And HCG is used to stimulate LH. HCG has also been used for weight control. Steichen and a few other people are really big on HCG. I haven't used too much of this because it's an injection and it's kind of a hassle. And it works, but it's not really a blockbuster. It has some interesting physiologic significance, but it's not a blockbuster. Hormonally, I use a lot of Arimidex. Arimidex is an estrogen blocker. Because what happens as testosterone levels rise, especially in guys, what happens is a lot of it gets aromatized into the estrogen pathway. And so, yeah, the testosterone rises, but then estrogen rises. And I'm trying to get that balance that they used to have when they were younger, where the testosterone's here and the estrogen's down here. So I look at that ratio there, which is sort of that more youthful ratio. And so I begin to use Arimidex. Now, weightlifters know about this. They can't get their hands on it, but this is what they're looking for, because they all start developing like this, you know, because they're doing way too much. So I mean, they're taking like, you know, gazillion times more than what I use or prescribe, and they're wondering why they're starting to develop out. So they're looking for stuff like Arimidex and Aromacin, which is one of the newer ones. These ones actually were developed for women with breast cancer. I think really ought to be the first line of drugs of therapy if you're going to treat women for breast cancer. But on the other hand, I don't think breast cancer is a hormonally caused disease anyway.
Is that like Biodim,
Biodim is I have to show you the pathways, but Biodim is trying to balance off estrone and estradiol, and there's different, there's 2, 4, and 16, there's different forms of estrone, and there's this is really cutting edge stuff, and the theory is that and I always forget which one it is, I think it's the 4 and 16, that are much more harmful forms of estrone, and the other one that's a less harmful. I think all estrones are harmful. I think estradiol is not as harmful as estrone. But the Biodim is an attempt to kind of correct those things. And Biodim really is basically a broccoli extract. So it's indole carbonyl. So dim is diindole methanol, which is two indole carbonyls stuck together. So it's these new natural things that actually, you know, this is where we get back to fruits and vegetables. It has the sulfurines and all those things in it. So you get that and you put that together, and it's supposed to really balance out a lot of the estrogen metabolism, so it's less harmful. But this is real cutting edge, because there's a whole camp of guys who are really into it, and there's another camp saying, no, we use the IC3. Then they say, oh, those guys are the dimwits and the dim guys. They know those guys don't have it right. And then there's other guys say, I don't know what this is all about. It's going to take a while to shake this all out. It's an interesting area.
What's the IC3?
IC3 is indole 3 carbonyl, which is from broccoli extract.
Yeah, kind of.
Basically. Okay. And then finally, it's salt palmito. And again, I'm in a distinct minority, which I usually am, because I was 30 years ago, I would say to all my medical student friends, I'd say, I don't believe in the cholesterol theory. They say, well, you're an idiot. I mean, everybody knows the cholesterol theory. I mean, that's a given. I said, yeah, but I don't believe in it because here are all the reasons why. It's too simple. It's much more complex. And here we are 30 years later, and one of my other main lectures is showing why half of all the people who have heart attacks have normal cholesterol, so that got proven out. Salt palmito, I'm kind of in the minority on this one. I think salt palmito works symptomatically to reduce size of prostate, prostatic hypertrophy, but I am convinced that salt palmito increases estrogen, and I don't want guys' estrogen going up, because there's a lot of evidence in the European literature, not American literature, but the European literature, that estrogen is just as much of an influence on the size of the prostate as testosterone is. See, what you hear in the paper is you'll say, oh, the reason why you're bald is because you got too much testosterone and too much DHT. Wrong. Well, I have the same amount of DHT. DHT stays about level as we get older. The reason why I'm bald is because I got genetics and because the receptors here. Notice I still got stuff here. And as we get older, it's all coming out here and it's coming out here. So it's not like we're losing here. It's like specific areas, receptor sites. It's not the drug, it's receptor sites, okay? So I'm concerned about estrogen promoting the size of prostate. So it seems how, for some reason, it does help symptoms, just as good as Proscar and all these other, Hytrin and the other drugs. But long term, I'm not a real advocate of salt.
Do you know much about beta testosterone?
I like it, but I can't see that as a blockbuster, but it's got some good aspects to it.
What does it do?
Beta testosterone helps with cholesterol, and there's some sexual things about it too. I'm not a real expert.
Prostate. I mean,
yeah, it's good for prostate health. I think it's one of those things, like, there's a whole category of, you know, it's a whole bunch of these that are good, but they're not, like, to me, like little blockbusters. I'm like, wow, this is really the main answer. It's like, it's good, I like it, but it's not been a major thing for me.
Is there any, I know that testosterone is very valuable for women. What value does estrogen have to men of any sort?
My feeling is this. I think in the main, after a certain point, estrogen is, I don't think it's real good for guys.
Like it has, zero estrogen would be a good thing?
No, I said after a certain point. What I mean by that is, we've seen in the last few years that unquestionably, that estrogen, this is what I tell everybody, estrogen is a brain drug. Testosterone is a doing drug. Testosterone is, I'm out there, I'm projecting out, I'm making lists, I'm prioritizing, we're getting things done, we're executing, we got a plan, let's move. That sound like some of you guys know? Because it's good for creative thinking, it's probably good for poets, it's good for guys who want to do creative thinking, whether it's an engineer, or a guy's a poet, or a guy's a writer, whatever. There's a certain level that's obligatory for everybody of estrogen, because it's a brain drug. We know that it really resides in the neurons, substance of the neurons, okay? So it's critical for neuronal health. And again, there's studies to show, and they're trying to cut these studies down and knock them down. But studies to show that, you know, good estrogen levels prevents Alzheimer's. Incidentally, there are also now some studies to show that good testosterone levels are going to prevent.
And good cholesterol, too.
That's the right amount of cholesterol. But right. Good testosterone levels are going to prevent Alzheimer's, okay? So a certain amount of estrogen in guys, I think, is right. I don't want the levels going real high. And what I'm saying is that most men after the age of 50, usually, it's because of putting on fat. Because fat somehow just turns that aromatase enzyme on, just kicks it up. And then there's some genetic stuff and other stuff that just didn't really make sense to me. As guys get older, their estrogen levels start going up as women are going down. Okay. So there's a certain amount that's good, but I don't want it above a certain amount.
When you use testosterone therapy, you've got your feedback loop decreases the LH.
Right.
You can run into testicular atrophy. How do you avoid that in your approach?
The way I avoid that is, you know, I'm so careful in using what I consider to be really physiologic doses that both clinically and laboratory-wise, what I do is, first of all, I look at the LH and the FSH, and it turns out rarely do I suppress those.
Because of the dosage?
Because of the doses I'm using, and actually guys don't get enough in there to actually suppress those. Occasionally that happens, but most of the time, I'm not suppressing those. And so if I don't suppress those, it means that I've got a good physiologic dose. And I'm always doing, all hormonal therapy that I do, my goal is always not to slam people. My goal is always to be really careful physiologically so that it's what I call just above the perceptual threshold. So a lot of people come back and say, well, yeah, I think it's helping, I'm feeling better, and I'm feeling more centered, and I'm getting more things done. I don't know if it's this or that, I'm not quite sure. It's just above the perceptual threshold.
Do you also cycle? In other words, it's not only the amount, but the cyclicity that allows...
Well, there's a diurnal variation, because cream, I'll do the cream maybe twice a day or once a day. Uh-huh. That's why I don't like injections, because injections are 24 hours a day. Now you're suppressing things, you don't have any cycle there. Women all cycle, although I've found out, I don't think it matters. Guys that don't cycle on and off, and some of that's because we haven't figured out what guys' cycles are. They are cycles, we haven't figured them out yet. They're longer cycles. But I've not found that to be a problem. And so the testicular atrophy, I've not found that to be a big problem. you find that a problem when guys are getting injections. And you find that because what they get is they get slammed the first 3 days, like their levels are like off the chart for about 3 or 4 days, and they're feeling like crank. I mean, yeah, love this. And then the last 3 or 4 days are kind of low. So it's not very physiologic at all. So you get these real high levels. Those are the guys coming with testicular atrophy. But the guys that I see, because we're doing it naturally, we're using, you know, usually topical creams, occasionally lozenges, it's a possibility, and maybe over 5 or 10 years, I begin to see a little of that. But it's not nearly as pronounced as guys who are coming in with injections.
Okay. How often do you measure their LH levels?
Well, you know, I'm nuts on lab testing. So, you know, the people who come to see me are really motivated, really motivated. So, you know, I'll do lab testing every 2 or 3 months. I got to tell you, a lot of guys in my business, they're tested maybe once, and then, yeah, it looks about right, it's fine. So save you money here. And you know, they may just test for another year. Maybe ever. Yeah, it looks about right. I'm really fastidious about it. I'm fastidious, one, because this is an ongoing study. Two, because the people I have, I'm in Silicon Valley, they want to know this stuff. They want to follow this. I mean, this is a learning experience. We spend a lot of time talking about it, a lot of time going over all this stuff. So they want to know what these things are. So every 2 or 3 months, they're following it, they're graphing it, you know. I mean, I get the guys who are so compulsive. They show me their list of vitamins, and it's on an Excel spreadsheet. And they've got, you know, they've got here's Bob, and here's Sharon, and well, here's the dog, here's the cat. And it's like twice a day, three times a day. And they got, I mean, it's huge spreadsheets. I got one guy who was, you know, big guy in Silicon Valley. He's huge spreadsheets. Keep all that stuff together. So they want to know all this data, okay? And for me, it's great because then I give all this information to you. I pass this out as an ongoing study because I have a huge amount of data at this point after 5 or 6 years. And also, it keeps me incredibly honest. This, you know, the medical board can come in and say, you know, you're doing a really unusual medicine. That's fine. But, you know, you show me where nothing's documented here because I'll put myself against any cardiologist. I'll put myself against any endocrinologist in town because I'm doing way more testing, much more sophisticated, much more comprehensive testing than any of these guys. Mm-hmm. The endocrinologists are still using tests. Every one of these guys, the best guy in town, still using tests that are 10 years out of date. Been doing that stuff for 10 years, you know, RAIs and you know, the T3 fractions. I mean, I'm doing free T3s and free T4s, TSH, reverse T3. That's the standard that the American Thyroid Association has promulgated. So, you know, I do this testing partly just because it protects me too. You know, it's like there's nobody's gonna ever impugn, well, what are you doing? Say, hey, well, that's fine. Here's my data. Here's what we're measuring, okay? You want us to, you have an issue with what we're doing in thyroid, fine. Here's all the data, okay? It's all here. So there's a number of reasons why I do so much testing. A lot of different reasons, all of which is positive for everybody.
Excuse me, I haven't seen DHEA mentioned.
Coming. And DHEA is let me get into this here. Nootropics, this is for cognitive enhancement, but interestingly, everything that is cognitive, this now you're getting into kind of the third level of one of my programs. We start at nutrition, then we go to hormonal, then we go to cognitive. Cognitive is what people are really interested in. Cognitive is the part of the brain, limbic system, hippocampus, amygdaloid system, and then kind of goes out into the left temporal lobe. But it's that primitive part of the brain where sexuality and memory and emotion are all kind of like pretty much the same place. It's all there. I mean, maybe there's like this kind of like sort of random disc there, but it's pretty much the same place. So anything that helps cognitive also tends to help sexuality. So Depanil, because of dopamine, really helps with cognitive awareness, because we're pumping up dopamine, it really kind of pumps us up, but also helps all the neuronal circuits, so tends to help sexuality. The one that really helps the most is DMA and choline. DMA and choline. Choline is one of those things that we're really running out of as we get older. Choline really helps everything that secretes, eyes, mouth, vaginal secretions, stomach secretions. Everything that secretes is all dependent on choline. Choline is what keeps us wet, secreting things. And as we get older, tend to dry out, you know, things are drying out. not drinking as much water, and things are kind of getting drier, and skin's getting drier. Choline is what really increases that, but also really increases memory and vitality. Choline is one of the things, the biggest bang for the buck. The DNA in choline is simple, and it's where really, I probably saw the biggest improvement in my memory, just that simple thing alone there, and it just really made me horny. So, that works. So these things have dual purpose, okay? Phosphatidylcholine, again, with DME. Gecko-biloba, again, I use for heart, I use for brain, I use for all vascular things. So this is a list of here, and I want to kind of get into this, the last line. You know, these are things that we use, micronutrients. These are the things that I talk to physicians about. What are the things that we use in the anti-aging medicine? Phytonutrients, antioxidants, biological herbs. Getting bigger and bigger and bigger on enzymes all the time. Bobbi and I are working on developing enzyme routines for cancer, cardiovascular, digestive, and just general nutritional and diabetes problems. Natural hormone is what we're talking about, growth hormone. So these are some of the things that we use. Now, these all, again, come into sexuality, but they also come into just hormonal, bigger in general. Sexuality just follows from that. Pregnenolone pumps up your progesterone levels. Also good for memory. There's a reason they thought it probably had some effect on joints. Natural progesterone, this comes from the PEPI study. I use a lot of natural progesterone, that's all I use. Now it's called Prometrium so that they can get paid for it. But I still don't think Prometrium is identical to the natural progesterone that I use. It's a different base. And the OBGYNs are using doses that are too large, because they're all using 200 milligrams. It's too much. It's way too much. Most women only need, say, 50 to 100 milligrams. Occasionally need 150. I don't have any women on 200 milligrams. But natural progesterone is important because, again, if you go in and you look at, again, you know, that whole estrogen issue there, they were using Provera, which is medroxyprogesterone acetate, which is a synthetic and not progesterone. The definitive study on estrogen and progesterone, what does this do? Does it cause cancer? Does it not cause cancer? Does it help bones? Does it not help bones? Is it good? Is it not good? Should we do it? Should not be doing it? It's never going to be done. Forget it. You're never going to see it. There's no money in it. There's no money in these drugs. Nobody's going to put the effort into it. And you, what you really want to do is, if you want to get a good study, you're going to take the nurses or you're going to take a population for 5 to 10 years, that's all you're taking, these drugs here, you're not going to take anything else for 5 or 10 years, and we're going to find out. The study is never going to be done. So everything you see, all these studies that have come out, and all the studies that are going to come out, are all going to be fatally flawed. You're not going to be able to make up your decision based on this, because it's like, this last one was using Premarin and Provera. That's not estrogen. Frankly, technically, I think from Premarin is a xenoestrogen. It is foreign to your body. The ones that they're using now more and more are Vivel, Clomera, Estrace, Ogan. Those are a little bit more natural because they are plant-based and they're estradiol. I don't have a problem with those. And some women, they really do well with them. I got a big problem with Premarin. And Provera, I wouldn't touch Provera with a 10-foot pole because I put everybody in natural progesterone. It's not the same drug. All the complications that they had in the study, that they showed in the study, it's been well known for 20, 30 years. This is nothing new. Just look at any birth control insert. It's all there. None of this is new. Headaches, thrombophlebitis, incidence of fibrocystic breast disease. All this stuff is not new. We've known about this for 20 or 30 years, 40 years. I mean, from the very beginning, from the early, late 60s. This is all old stuff. It's just recycled. Here's what I found out recently. Big revelation. But it'll help you. Even more so now. When they do all these newspaper articles and stuff you read in the newspaper, sad to say, they're not trying to enlighten you. They're selling papers. They're not trying to enlighten you. And even the reporters, maybe like, you know, I don't know, 1 in a million report, 1 in a 1,000, they really have the right idea. Maybe they're trying to, but I think they probably get to the editor and say, no, you gotta snap that up. So they interviewed me last week on growth hormone. First thing I said, it's an investigative report. You know, are you interested in enlightenment or are you just interested in headlines? oh, yeah, we're interested in getting the truth. And I knew they weren't. And they saw the headline of the story. It's Chronicle. Okay, so they interviewed me, and you see there where they actually did get the right quote, but the headline was, growth hormone, big problems, needs more study, dangerous. I hate this illogic. So I was thinking, and again, it's related to all this stuff here, and I'm giving this to you in terms of, you know, how do you make sense as lay people of all the story? Well, I heard a story here, and then I heard a story there, and I don't know what to do, and whose website do I go to, and then I saw Life Extension Foundation, and then Whitaker said this, and then Dr. Williams said this, and Bobbi said this, and I don't know. What do I make of all this stuff? Most of it follows from illogic. It's not logical. Studies are badly performed. Results don't follow. So it's difficult. But if you understand that the headlines are not telling you the story, so what I started thinking is, it's almost like as if your headline says, you know, youth caught speeding in neighborhood at 120 miles an hour hits tree. Conclusion: all cars are bad. We got to ban those cars, right? I mean, that's what it comes down to. All cars are bad. No, that guy was driving that car too fast. But let's look at logic, okay? So, you know, so I was talking earlier. I said, you know, I think maybe all reporters, you know, before you start writing, you better take a course in logic.
Critical thinking.
It's a wishful.
You mentioned progesterone for women. What about for men?
I started using progesterone in men for a while for prostate issues because I thought it would really balance out testosterone. And then I found out, and I don't have the answer to this, but the stuff that I do, and I don't know whether it's in the carotenoids or it's the fish oils are magic, but there's something that I'm doing. Every guy who comes to see me starts out with low progesterone, and within a month, his progesterone levels are higher than I want them to be. And I'm not giving them progesterone. Wow. So they all come up. All guys will all come up. They'll almost all of them. Much more, even more than women. I mean, I have guys who are, you know, floating around with testosterone, progesterone levels 6,000, 7,000. And, you know, I have trouble getting women up that high. So again, guys are getting higher than women are, you know, as they get older. Okay. DHA, you asked about DHEA.
What do you attribute that to?
I don't know. I'm not sure. Well, the RNA is. I think it's the fish oils are magic. And I've read recently there's certain things in the carotenoids that probably help promote progesterone levels. And I'm not quite sure what it is. Okay. DHEA is another one that's real controversial. But DHEA is real simple. It's really simple. You're going to read lots of stories. DHEA is bad, causes tumors in trout. Don't have DHEA. Causes tumors in rats, yes, at 3,000 times the dose. Okay. You know what that means? It means like, okay, you have to swallow this much DHEA a day. Okay? I might couldn't shovel that much in you a day, okay? You say, well, that causes tumors. Yeah. Well, yeah, if I drank, you know, a room full of water a day, that would be toxic. Okay? I mean, it gets out of the realm of logic, okay? But they don't know this, you know. Rats develop tumors, okay? They get peroxisomal proliferation at 3,000 times the normal dose, okay? So I'm giving guys 50 milligrams, maybe 3 grams of DHEA. You can't get that much, okay? And so, and they interviewed the researcher who did this one study on rats. They said, well, I didn't mean to imply that what I was doing here had anything to do with humans. It's just an experiment. I just thought I'd give these rats a lot of DHEA. That's all I was doing. But again, the illogic was, oh, you know, really bad. That's why I don't like animal studies. I don't like animal studies because they take these extreme bizarre situations and say, oh, we gave a huge amount here, and that's going to be bad to humans. Well, A, you know, if you're going to do animal studies, and nobody's going to do this, but to me, if you want to do animal studies, do them on orangutans and chimps, because they're the only ones that are closest to humans. But don't tell me about these rat studies and spider studies and you know, trout studies. I mean, trout livers. I mean, it gets to be kind of ridiculous. But this is what you read. This is what you read. DHEA found to cause tumors in trout. Okay. Be sure to remember that I'm not feeding my goldfish DHEA. That's simple, easy, soft. Okay. So DHEA raises testosterone levels in women, but not in men. Well, no. But they keep talking about this. That's well known. DHE levels cause testosterone levels to rise in women, but not in men. So DHEA really does other thing in men. DHEA increases sense of well-being, stress coping abilities. DHEA probably kind of slips down the estrogen pathways.
I just wanted to turn back for a moment to ask about testicular atrophy.
Yeah.
How fast does it come on? What does it look like? It sounds like it's not reversible.
Yeah.
And, that's significant. So I'd like, if you could say anything more about that.
Let me be rhetorical. What's significant about it?
Well,
I'm being devil's advocate.
I would be
what's
concerned
about
with
it?
Somebody taking testosterone therapy of some sort that
right.
they've been giving. I actually know someone who takes testosterone injections, and he says, well, I was low testosterone anyway, so it doesn't matter that I'm on this for the rest of my life. And,
right.
and he doesn't care about his testicles, I guess,
right.
in atrophy. I don't even know what they look like when they're atrophied. And
can't see them.
Now we go back to the topic here, sexuality and why he was.
His sexual drive is really up there,
right.
and he takes it for his business to keep sort of
right.
aggressively sort
right.
of pushing ahead. So.
Okay. So there's two issues that are involved.
Uh-huh.
The two issues, and I thought I'd sort of address this. Number one is the testicular atrophy. I don't like seeing testicular atrophy because it tells me that I've been slamming the drug too hard.
You don't use it enough to have that.
Number two, as you heard, I don't use injections. I don't like injections. I don't use injections. They're not physiologic.
Mm-hmm.
Guys get too high levels. I don't like things that are not physiologic. And there's good evidence that injections increase sex-binding globulin. And as sex-binding globulin is like this big ship that floats around, and it binds all the testosterone. As it binds testosterone, less of it's free.
Mm-hmm.
So you actually end up having to do more and more and more, because as sex-binding globulin starts rising in men, more of it's bound, not free. So that's a side effect. But it's easy. I don't use injections.
Mm-hmm.
So when I use the creams and lozenges, more physiologic, diurnal variation, circadian rhythms, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I don't see that. I just don't see
yeah.
it. But I'm being a little facetious and a little rhetorical in that, well, in a sense, is there a problem with it? There probably is, but I know that's the main problem. Okay.
So
in other words, what I'm saying is there may be, because you could say, well, there may be a relationship to the testicular atrophy and, oh, incidentally, Annie developed a brain tumor 20 years later. Well, I don't think that caused the brain tumor, but I think that was a marker for you're getting way too much. Like Lyle Azevedo, remember him?
Yeah.
Okay, Lyle Azevedo was a linebacker with
the Raiders.
And he died of brain tumor. Okay, he was a guy, like a lot of them, who were taking way too much. Way too much. Everything that I do is always done physiologic, just above the perceptual threshold. So you're really not quite sure. Yeah, I'm feeling really good, but you don't feel slammed. I'm not out to overdose people. I'm not out to just say, wow, yeah, I'm doing it. I got one guy comes to see me. He's so busy. He didn't have time for his protein shake. He's busy. He's got all these businesses, and he wants his growth hormone. But I'd start doing 2 units because it was better. And he's always like this. I don't want to deal with him. Because he's not listening to me. He's not doing things physiologic. He's not part of the program. He's out of control. My patients are not out of control. They understand we're doing this. There's a rhythm. There's a momentum. There's a certain rate at which this thing unfolds, and it unfolds just the way it's supposed to. It's not too fast, and you're not overdoing it.
Speaking of rhythm, the cortisone and insulin being high suppresses a lot of these things. Is that right? Like it suppresses testosterone and dopamine? Looking at it, controlling those
by diet. That's a real complex issue. Cortisone, that's one of the things that people talk about. As we get older, cortisol levels go up and up and up. I don't see that, and that may be just the people I see. I'm always worried about cortisol levels too low. I see some guys who have high cortisol levels, but when I see cortisol levels, give or take, there's a lot of variation, but as a general rule, guys who have high cortisol levels related to work stress, And women who have high cortisol levels, which are always much higher, when women are stressed, their cortisol levels go through the roof. When guys get high cortisol levels, they're high, they don't go through the roof. And with women, their cortisol levels are almost always related to relationships. And that could be at work, or it's at home, kids, family, whatever. But, you know, this is what's different about men and women. Women, it's relationships. It's like, oh, yeah, incidentally, my daughter's driving me nuts, my husband's driving me nuts, or that lady down the hall, or stuff. But it's a relationship. Guys, it's like, man, I can't get the damn contract done, we can't get all this stuff done. So cortisol levels rise, but then you have to figure out how much of the cortisol, again, is a marker for stress. And when we get stressed, all these other things don't work as well. Because people say, well, we weren't having sex because we were stressed and we were thinking about other stuff. Never stopped me. Stress never stopped me. But a lot of people will say that, okay. So I don't know whether the cortisol is directly affecting that or whether that's just a marker.
That means that if these things are rising in the morning, go to the lab, you don't see the high level.
Cortisol levels are highest in the morning.
Yeah.
There are people who have this pathologic insomnia where I think they get inverted levels where their cortisol levels are higher in the night than during the day. Okay. And there's a lot of people say, I don't like doing blood. Cortisol is a very complex subject. It's really complex. I'm co-authoring a book right now. I went over this with my writer. We must have spent 2 or 3 days, and I said, this is one area that's not clearly discussed. It's very complex. It goes back to Hans Selye, working in the late 50s. Very complex subject. You need to read Sapolsky. So we've gone through the rest of this. So let me just kind of finish up on one or two things here. Growth hormone is something I do a lot. Growth hormone is not a major thing for sexuality, but it helps. Some people get more out of it, some people get less. It's a little thing, just another thing, kind of increases mood, sensuality, decreases stress, invincibility, just feel really good. All that stuff helps sex. De-stressing, getting in the mood, just paying attention. So growth hormone, you know, these are the things that we look at for growth hormone. Stimulates strength of heart muscle, bone, increases lean muscle mass, skin elasticity, and then you see at the bottom here, sense of well-being, cruise libido, and sexual pelvis. Does a lot of that stuff. Maybe some of it, maybe do all of it. It's different for each person. But it's part of a whole rich array of things that we can bring to the subject here.
How do you do a physiological approach with that, with the growth hormone?
Let me skip on that for a second. So these are things that we do in my center in Los Gatos. We look at longevity anti-aging medicine. Starts out with nutritional medicine, natural hormone replacement therapy, which is what we've been talking about quite a bit tonight. Menopause and andropause. Andropause is guys going through changes at 54 to 55. Menopause, typically women at 48 to 50 to 51, although I have women who went through menopause at 38. I've had quite a few women who are going through menopause in their early 40s. So the average is 50, and they'll say the average is actually 52 to 53 is the point of menopause, and perimenopause starts at about 45, 46, but big wide variation there. Guys go through the same change, it's more subtle, it's not as evident, so we're not recognizing it as a clinical syndrome, but I can tell you there's no question that andropause exists in men every bit as much as in women. The only problem is, number one, it's more subtle, comes on slower. And the problem with andropause is the very nature of them never getting treated, which is andropause to me is basically, it's the dwindles. It's guys just kind of fading out. And because they're fading out, guys don't go to docs anyway. Women, this is the one time in life when women and men change roles. When a guy has a problem, he fixes the problem. When a woman has a problem, she comes to the guy and says, I got all this problem. He's thinking, okay, you need to do this. No, I just want you to listen. Well, then I just want you to listen. Let's kind of feel good about it. We're working on this. Yeah, I feel better about it. When it comes to health, women are definitive. Women get their health taken care of. Men don't. It, It's got to be falling off, got to have intractable pain, something obviously doom and gloom. Maybe I'll go to the doc. I'm just as bad as all the rest, okay? Men don't go to docs. Women do. So this is one area where women really are so much more proactive than men. I'm pretty lucky because I get a different population. My population is actually pretty even, guys and women. But I get a different, it's a very special population. So andropause is guys who, guys don't normally go to docs. And now here's a guy where I'm kind of fading and I'm fading out. Usually he's brought in by his wife. He's kind of sitting there, and she's doing all the talking. And then it's like, okay, here's what you need is testosterone. You're going to fret, like, should I take it? I don't know. My doc said it's not good for my prostate, and I don't know if I should. And like 6 months later, I don't know. I'm still thinking about it, still thinking. And it's like, God, you need this so bad. Please take this. I had one guy who came in to see me. I didn't want to see him. His name is Hispanic, and he did speak English very well. But he was really insistent. You really wanted to see you. I got to see you, doc. I got to see you, doc. And so his English was just good enough. And he'd only been here 25 years. But he knew that he had andropause. He was about 55. And he had gone to a doc that was pretty good in Juarez. And doc said, I think you got problems with your testosterone. Of course, nobody's going to treat this guy. Oh, we don't do that. He came to me. Anxious, depressed, no sleep, no sex. I mean, he was like classic case. And so bad, I thought, okay. And he'd been put on Elavil and Prozac and Restoril and Elavil. And I mean, he'd put on all these different medicines. And even I had to kind of short-term maybe treat him with a few of these. But that wasn't what his problem was. And so I said, I really had to gut this one out. Because I knew this was it. But boy, he was so disturbed. He was so distressed. He kept calling me every couple of days. It's not working yet. 6 weeks later, he's been on testosterone. He's walking, I'm here. Sleeps better? The anxiety is better? Depression? No depression. Sex is good. I mean, this guy was totally different. This is like one of the most dramatic cases I've seen of andropause. So, as with women in their late 40s with menopause, when they come to their OBGYN, they're depressed and they got brain fog and all that, they're not suffering low levels of Prozac. That's not the problem. It's not low levels of Prozac in the blood, okay? It's their hormones are not balanced, okay? Same thing with men. The problem is they need to get this hormonal balancing, okay? And this comes from my mentor who said, many years ago, comes from four generations of endocrinologists in Belgium. He started looking at psychology, he started looking at depression and psychology, and he really saw that most mood disorders are hormonally based. There are some people who are truly really depressed, who really have transmitter problems, who probably really, they don't have enough of the right receptors, serotonin receptors are down or whatever. But probably 80-90% or more of people who have mood disorders, a little bit of depression, anxiety, can't think, brain fog, hormonal imbalances. And if we can get all that right, that's what's the answer to menopause, that's what's the answer to andropause. And that's what a lot of this stuff is all about. And I do a lot of work with lipid disorders, that's a whole other lecture that I give. It's a rich, rich array of things. And we finally finish up with stress management.
Now, just before that, I wanted to ask you, there are age-related levels to, for instance, DHEA and growth hormone, and I don't know if it is with testosterone, but anyway, is there a certain age level that you like to, when you talk about keeping things within physiologic levels, is there a certain age level norm that you like to keep your patients at?
Again, I use all the lab work so interpretively that, I look at these ranges, and these ranges, but it's so complex where these ranges come from. So if I'm going to shoot for a range with all these hormones, if you have to pin me down a number, generally in my population, I'm trying to shoot for where would these normally be between about 35 and 45. So I'm not trying to bring all of you back to where you were when you were 18 or 20, because almost everybody in their 50s say, both men and women say, well, I want that vigor, but you know, I don't want it that good. I mean, I don't want to be thinking about sex all the time. It's like really distracting. I mean, not all the time. Just some of the time, but not all the time. So they don't want to be back like, God, I don't want to be with 18. So you bring them back to 35 or 45, which is really a good, healthy mid-range, okay? And you know, my sports heroes right now are guys, you know, like Barry Bonds, 38. I mean, look at this guy. This guy is one of the few guys at 38 is getting better. So we're looking at guys between 35 and 45 as like, in some ways, really prime peak age. But on the other hand, if I, who?
Jerry Rice. He's
and Jerry Rice, the other one too. Jerry Rice. And you know, and there's a few other guys we're gonna be in that. Actually, in a way, Gordie Howe, you know, 50 was doing that stuff. But Jerry Rice and Barry Bonds are the best examples. I mean, these guys are like still top of their game, 38, 39, 40 years old. That's not supposed to happen. So I do that, but then on the other hand, let's say someone comes in their 70. I'm not trying to get the 70-year-old down to 35, okay? So I'm telling you, this is real interpretive. If I'm looking for function, which is a combination of how you feel, how do you act, where are the levels, kind of, I'm really looking for, as a rule, give or take, about 15 to 20 years younger than where you were. So if you're at 70, I want you back where you were when you were 55. Because when you're 70, you're saying, man, I would love to be 55 again. And when you're 50, you say, love to be 35 again. See, I used to say, you know, what is the definition of old?
15 years older than you are now.
Exactly. I thought I made that up, you know, and then I found that some famous guy said that it's actually 15 or 20. It's basically 20 years old. So when you're 10, man, 30, you're really old. Right?
True.
And when you're 30, well, yeah, but I'm not 50. Yeah. You know, and when you're 50, God, I don't want to be 70. And when you're 70, well, 90, that's pretty old. So anything 20 years old. And then converse, my goal with everybody, mentally, physically, hormonally, lipid-wise, I mean, my lipids now are better than they were when I was 20. They are better now. My lipid profile, because I've been following them since I was 22, my lipid profile is better than it was when I was 20 years old. But the hormonal stuff, I'm looking for about 15, 20 years. But it's really, it's a combination of how you feel, how you act, how things working for you, where are the levels. Because if you ask me what's the ideal estrogen level, there isn't any ideal estrogen. You ask me the ideal progesterone level, there isn't any one. Okay? If you ask me the ideal testosterone level, I'd say, well, give or take 25 to 30 picograms per cc, but estrogen progesterone, there is no ideal. Okay? Because you may be Asian, and your levels are never going to be real high. And you may be some other stock. Or you may be built a certain way, or you may be what I call alpha female, or, I mean, there's a whole lot of stuff that goes into what way this stuff looks. You know, what are we getting back to? So a lot of it, the most important part of it is, you know, is what's being lost here, which is talk to your patients. Listen to them. What are they telling you? What do they want? What are the goals? Where are you going? This is why, at the end here, what I'm saying is, here's the guy, now he's 85. Look at him. I don't think it's even a prop. He's still on Muscle Beach. Okay? What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to show that the goal of anti-aging medicine, which is gonna have to be the goal of medicine in general, is process-oriented, which is we're working toward a goal. This is a process of where we're working. It's got to be functional. We're restoring or we're preserving function. So we got to get away from the old concepts in medicine, which are terribly limited and they are not working, except if you're in the ER and you're banged up, you got a subdural hematoma, or you got a heart attack, or you got a ruptured spleen. That, you know, fine, get me to the ER, get me the best guy, do the old stuff, fine, get me in the ER. But most of what we suffer from, most of the stuff that people go to docs for, 89% is not ruptured spleen, subdural hematomas, cardiovascular events. It's this little stuff, I'm running out of energy. I'm fatigued. I don't have as much vigor. I got brain fog. I can't figure out where I left my keys yesterday, today, this morning, whatever. It's that kind of stuff, okay? That's what's afflicting all of us, all those little things. Functional medicine is saying, first of all, it starts with you're always looking functionally, therefore, you know, never want it to be structural. So you want to treat the thyroid before it becomes a structural problem. You want to treat these things before they become a structural problem. Cancer, things that are really big. And we got to get away from this thing that, you know, is that this is one thing that is fostered by the AMA. Everybody criticizes the AMA for, oh, the AMA said this, the AMA said that. The AMA is worthless. They're a toothless dog. The AMA does nothing. You don't understand. I wish the AMA did something. And me as a doc, I wish they did something as a trade union. I wish they would do something for me. The AMA is worthless. You understand? AMA only does one thing now. The AMA does one thing, and most docs don't even realize this. What does the AMA do? What do they do now?
Well, they're a political organization.
They're not even that.
I mean, they're not effective.
They're not even that. The AMA sells CPT and ICD-9 codes. That's where I think they make most of their money. I think that's the main raison d'etre now for the AMA.
Oh,
so what that is they're controlling all the coding, which the insurance companies use, fostering this whole structural, pathology-based, late-stage intervention system. That's the only place that the AMA has anything that I wish they wouldn't be doing. Other than that, AMA is irrelevant in this whole equation. But if we get away from this structural, pathology, late-stage intervention, I'm broke, now fix me up. Well, you know, why didn't you come to me like 20 years ago? Well, I got osteoporosis and I can't do it. Well, what have you been doing for yourself for the last 20 or 30 years? Well, I need some Fosamax or whatever. That's what anti-aging medicine is about. So it's, you know, you got to take responsibility for yourself. I've now shown you that there's economic, political, and social imperatives. We are running out of money. We don't have the resources, the money. We're not going to have the inclination. The inclination is in the whole push and you know, even the intellectual investment in figuring all this stuff out. It's gone. So all the stuff that my dad, when he was getting older, said, "Oh, look at the VA bought me. They bought me this scooter because he had MS, and he had all these things. I mean, he really had everything." Oh, the AMA bought the VA bought me this scooter, and they bought me this scooter. Actually, they bought me three scooters, and this thing here, and they got me on dialysis and all that. And he needed it, but we're not going to have money to do bypasses on every one of you when you guys have problems. We don't have money to do dialysis on every one of you. You know, bypasses that are at least $50,000, $100,000. Dialysis is going to cost $50,000 to $100,000. We're not going to have that kind of money. They're not telling you that. They're talking about Social Security because it's a safe subject. They know, even though they're raiding the fund, that one, they got a little time there. They got to about 2020, 2030. Medicare, they're mum, because that one is a train wreck. That's a train that's about ready to hit the wall in the next couple of years. Yeah. It's incumbent upon every one of us, every one of you, every one of us, to start taking responsibility for ourselves, our own health. And that's what anti-aging medicine is all about. Functional medicine. Looking at how I'm going to take care of myself, self-responsibility, and you find people who can help act collaboratively with you putting these programs together. I work at a very high level. I take extremely complex problems now, and I take people who really want whole programs because I'm a pioneer. I've been doing this right from the beginning. But you're going to begin to see, you know, guys will take more, you know, this will start diffusing out, and you'll start seeing more and more of it. And whether what I'm doing then becomes then generalize to a greater set. The idea is going to be we're going to have to move more toward functional medicine, goal-oriented, process-oriented, rather than, I got a problem, fix me up, I'll be out of here. What's the pill, I'm out of here. You know, the whole thing, the doc's hand is on the doorknob. Yeah, that's fine, that's great, yeah, good, fine. Here's the prescription, talk to my nurse. Nice seeing you. How's your 2 minutes? You know, you got 10 problems, 2 minutes. So let's talk about a couple of books that, you know, these are kind of interesting books. These are things now beginning to come out just in the last couple of years on andropause. This was by Jonathan Wright, well known, Vitality and Potency.
I think it's great, by the way.
Pardon?
I just said I think it's a great book, and I love
it. It is a good book.
Yeah.
He's got really good, this is a really good book. testosterone shipping. Shipping's now one of the big ones who really, I think it was a GP, decided to learn more about testosterone. Remember, the problem with testosterone is that we are so far behind the Europeans. The Germans knew all the stuff, been using all this stuff since the late 30s. It's not new for the Germans or for the Europeans. We're just beginning to say, well, maybe it's okay. And I think the reason is, and the reason why anti-aging medicine will be sort of halted and kind of stutter, start, start, stutter, because of morality. Well, if, I don't know about those hormones. I've heard they're good, they're not good. Europeans don't have a problem. So this is really a really interesting book. This is by Candace Pert, who was, I think, at NIH, had some political problems. Really interesting book on biochemistry. The biochemistry of hormones, how they interact with each other. Very, very interesting book, and really well put together. This is a book that's really a cute book. This is by John Morgenthaler and Dan Joy. I love the title. And this is pure joy. This is lust, sex, drugs, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll. But what it is really it's kind of going through, you know, what are the things that if you have problems, what are, you know, what are some unusual ones that you've not heard about besides Viagra? That, you know, and you can kind of go through it, and you can kind of skim it, and maybe it has value, maybe it doesn't. But it just shows you, again, there's a rich array of resources out there, things that you can bring to your command.
Did Morgenthaler do smart drugs?
Yeah, he did smart drugs, he did this series. And this one was given to me by one of my really cool patients who's a 74-year-old guy who used to go down to Mexico to spend most of the time with his 23-year-old girlfriend. And it's a professor emeritus at Berkeley. He gave me this book, really interesting. Again, just another level of looking at of, you know, what is sexuality in mankind, where does that fit in? Because it's kind of interesting, really, at one level. If you look at sexuality, sexuality is, in one sense, is part of the grand plan. And the grand plan is, every one of us in this room are past the age. Because the grand plan is, basically, is to pass the seed and then to exit stage left. We all become what Regelson used to call supernumeraries, meaning that we don't biologically have function here because we've already procreated and participated in the grand plan. So there are other things that give sex meaning, there are other things that give us joy, and there are other things that make our lives of value to everybody else and to ourselves, but it goes beyond the grand plan. The grand plan is we're all at this point dispensable. But we're all going to live, if we do all this stuff right, 60, 70, 80, 90 years old. So there are other things that are going to drive us. In today's world, which is increasingly becoming difficult and vicious and going the wrong way, the best we can really do is do good works. Be good to people, to your family, to people, even on the highway. Not flip people off. Bobbi and I were talking about it. Some guy just hit her car as she was getting out of her car. I said, well, I was mad at you. I mean, we need to learn how to get along. So getting older and all of this is a matter of learning how to still live in a civil world. And maybe, God forbid, maybe even learning a little politeness. I mean, that's getting to be kind of old-fashioned. I mean, my son would think, Dad, you're an idiot. Politeness is something I'd like to see come back in fashion.
Is there anybody that you would recommend that you showed the two books for male vitality and potency and then Shippen? Who's writing about women and menopause and vitality and that stuff?
Oh, God.
John Lee is one guy.
I mean,
who would you recommend?
Well, let me give you an example, because the one that comes to my mind to begin with is, and this is where my memory starts, because you'll know who it is exactly. It'll come to me in a second.
Christine Northrup.
Huh?
Christine Northrup.
Yeah, Christine Northrup. Christine Northrup's book, the last one that she did, is probably one of her best books. It's a great book. Okay. The reason why I hesitated is because, again, this goes back to what I said about the difference between men and women. If you went into a bookstore 20 years ago and said, I'd like to buy a book on menopause, and say, what did you say? Menopause? What's that? You go into any bookstore today, and there's a huge section of menopause. Mm-hmm. You know, there must be hundreds of books, okay? Now look for the andropause, it's like, well, yeah, there's like three up here, okay? You gotta wait another 20 years before guys begin to say, you know, I think we need to write about this a little bit more. And guys who are not just saying, you know, just take it easy, it's a part of life, okay? So you'll see more and more. But Christine Northrup, there's a lot of people. John Lee here in the community here, you know, lives in Santa Rosa, you know, wrote some really interesting works on what your doctor won't tell you about menopause, what your doctor won't tell you about perimenopause, and I think he's got a new one, what your doctor won't tell you about cancer. And his whole thing is really bringing progesterone into consciousness is a really important topic. I don't totally agree with everything he says, but just the fact that you're bringing it into discussion in a major work, okay? Mm-hmm. But there's really a lot of people. Christine's a good one to start out with, but there's a lot of people.
Wait, so what's the name of her last book? You said it was a big one.
Yeah, it's...
Is that the magic, the meaning of menopause or whatever?
It's around menopause. It's the magic of menopause. I can't remember the exact title, but it's a bestseller book.
Did you look at this book, Natural Hormone Replacement, NEH, NAP, Natural Hormone Enhancement, called Natural Hormone Enhancement?
By who?
Fabian.
Yes, I think I know. Is he was a exercise physiologist.
Probably a weightlifter.
Yeah, he's a weightlifter. Someone gave me that book. I think it's the one that I've seen. I haven't read through that.
There's about 1,000 references.
He's an interesting book. He's got a lot of interesting stuff. It's real complex. It's an interesting book.
Well, what's his name again?
Fabian. Yeah, I don't know exactly.
Rob
Fabian.
But he's got references to all these books. And Natural Hormone Enhancement.
So we're coming to a close. Thank you for attention. And I hope I've answered some of your questions, because what I wanted to give you was an overview of not just the sexuality, but show you how the sexuality in all its facets fits into the larger picture of what anti-aging medicine is, what it's going to mean for us to grow older, to maintain that vigor, both physically, mentally, and sexually, and how important that's going to be.